You always been good.
Thank you. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Oh, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Give you all the thanks.
Let everybody just stand this morning and just in the prayer of the Spirit.
Thank you.
Pray the Spirit.
Thank you.
Our night, we pray for you, just a little bit of battle minutes. We just want to do it in the Spirit. Everybody. Whatever you do in word or in deed, we say, do it heartily. Do it heartily. Shalom. The pray the Spirit. Everybody pray in the Spirit. It's a subject that God requires and He has commanded us to do. We shouldn't have to be exalted to do this. We ought to do it without everybody pray in the Spirit. Stay fierce. Build up on your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. Oh, let us pray with all our hearts. Feel the Holy Spirit, Lord, to be equipped and strengthened and anointed. Oh, let's pray in the Holy Ghost. Let's pray in the Holy Ghost. Let's pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Let's pray. Inshallah. Nandolomoko. Nandolomoko. Let's pray in the Holy Ghost. For the Lord's secret sake. They that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Yes. The best way to worship Him is to pray in the Holy Ghost. And to go beyond your tiredness, your weakness, the barriers to heaviness. Oh, God, we go beyond our limitations of the barriers. Walk in the Spirit. Yes, they that are in the flesh. Oh God, we get out of our mama. We get out of our flesh. Go beyond our higher. Yes. Hallelujah. Oh, let's pray that in Him and in the higher. Let's pray in the Holy Ghost. Yes, shout out. Yeah.
Pray in the Holy Ghost. Probably very passive
and just kind of let, you know, things kind of go and just keep everybody just stay in that same zone that you are very comfortable with. You're very comfortable not exerting effort, not persevering, not letting go and let God. You're very comfortable like that. And if you continue like that, the motivation for accomplishing what we want to accomplish before Jesus comes, the chances are we won't accomplish it. Now, y'all can't receive that, y'all don't believe it, but we got to do a little bit more if we want to get more results. We got to give more of ourselves in worship and praise and prayer and the works that Jesus told us to do in order for us to be able to accomplish more than what we have in the past. Amen. So I just wanted to continue tonight. I want you to make sure that you get these scriptures, because pleasing God is something that should be your desire, your motivation, your goal, your purpose. Pleasing God. Amen. Everybody say, pleasing God. Amen. So that's what we are trying to do. We're not trying to, we don't want to continue to operate on our level and do things our way and to accomplish very little as we, you know, are doing now. We want to rise to a level where we can begin to really please God, and I believe that the works and the results will begin to follow. I'm going to give you some scriptures tonight. Of course, you have the main scriptures that I started. Pleasing God is the same as what does the Lord require of us, and I've given you that. I'm not going to read it again. Deuteronomy 10, and that's 12 and 13. Okay, Deuteronomy 10, that's verses 12 and 13. So, pleasing the Lord is simply fearing the Lord, walking in all of his ways, and keeping his commandments, and doing all that he has called us to do. In short, we say, obey and serve. Obey and what? Serve. Amen. So that is included. The obedience is a big issue, and it entails a whole lot of things. Loving the Lord with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength is what we mean by obedience. Jesus said, if you love me, you will what? Do what I say do. Okay, so the thing that we want to get firmly established in our hearts is that God has called us to what? To obey him. And obey means not doing things the way you want to do them. And that includes your prayer and your worship of God, too. You know, we spent the first 30 minutes in worship. And it shouldn't be just a routine. I mean, it should be the giving the best that you have to the Lord. Scripture says that whatever we do in word or in deed, amen, do it heartily as unto the Lord. See, that's scripture, and sometimes we just let that pass right over us, and we just still do things the way we want to do them. Okay, but that's the scripture, Deuteronomy 10, verses what? Okay, 12 and 13. Okay, so what we get out of that, what we take away, fear of the Lord is the first thing that God requires. That means a wholesome dread of displeasing God. That's what I always say. So you don't have to ever have to wonder how I define fear. Fear of the Lord. It's a wholesome dread. Everybody ought to remember the wholesome dread of what? Displeasing God. Amen. I'm going to ask you 5 minutes from now and see how many can tell me what the fear of the Lord is. Okay, so fear of the Lord is a wholesome dread of displeasing the Lord. So that simply means you want to do what the Lord says do, and you want to serve him with all that's within you. You want to serve him. Amen. You must work, you know, we used to sing this song, I must work until the work is done. Amen. All right. The second scripture that you want to know by memory is Ecclesiastes, I believe it's 12. So that's the scripture that we quoted many times. We don't read it, but it's a scripture that summarizes our responsibility to God. This is what the Lord is requiring of us. This is what the Lord is expecting. And we quote this scripture many times during funerals because it really brings to bear a whole lot of the things that people have really kind of overlooked. Here is the conclusion of the whole matter, fearing God. See, in both of these scriptures, it's highlighting fearing the Lord. And there's no way we can really get around it. I'm going to give you some brand new, but not brand new, the scriptures that I haven't been focusing on now in terms of pleasing the Lord. And when I say pleasing the Lord, it doesn't mean just living the life as most of us, you know, actually do, but it's also serving the Lord the way he wants to be served. And that's the reason why God gives us the grace of ministering grace. That's what I want to say, ministering grace. God has given us saving grace. God has given us what? Keeping grace, or we call it standing grace, or overcoming grace. So all of these graces are in the package, and God has released these graces into our lives. Saving grace, and I could define each one, but needless to do that tonight, we have overcoming grace, and then we have what? Ministering grace. So the ministering grace and the overcoming grace all are designed to equip us to, Scripture says, to run our race and to complete our course and to fulfill the work that God has assigned to all of our hands. So this scripture in Ecclesiastes says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandment, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment. You know, that sounds kind of really scary. Every work, every secret deed, even the intents of your heart, your motives, all of these things are going to come into play in the judgment. Whether we're talking about the judgment seat of Christ, which would be the first judgment. Amen. Saints will be judged first. Everybody understand that, right? Saints will be judged. There'll be a lot of judgments. It will just need more than two. White throne and the judgment seat. But the saints will be judged first. The Bible says now it's come that judgment first began in the house of the Lord, and what shall the end be to them that obey not the gospel? So judgment will be, amen, executed among the, what, the saints first. We call it the judgment seat of Christ. Everybody said the judgment seat of Christ. And that's what 1 Corinthians 3, I believe, that 11, 12, 13, whatever it is, talking about no other foundation can no person lay, but the one that has been laid. And it talks about any man deal on the what rock, on the gold, silver, and what precious stones, their works will merit rewards. And then it talks about the wood, hay, and stubble builders, and those works will be what? Burned. And the person's soul, if they made an effort, if they were actively involved, you know, faith without works, if you don't do nothing, you just don't show up at the judgment seat, period. But if you have tried, and you tried it in the flesh, and you did it half-heartedly, you know, and your motives and your objective was to please yourself, whatever it might be, amen, then those are kind of works that God cannot reward. It's done in the power of your own human strength. And, you know, that's the reason why we need to be at our best. Yes.
Amen.
I say amen. We need to be at our best. Amen. The Bible says that over and over, and I'm going to pull out some scriptures in a minute. Whatever you do, in word or in deed, do it what? Heartily, as unto the Lord. Amen. So I'm trying to get the best of you to emerge. And it's not going to be easy. But one thing for sure, next month, we want everybody to have a soul in this church. We want everybody. Amen. You better, if you have to pray, fast, whatever you got to do. Amen. Even Pastor Hill, I'm placing myself under the same criteria. Amen. I believe that everybody can what? Reach out and persuade somebody, encourage somebody, and minister into somebody's life in some kind of way that will compel them to come and what? Be under the word. It's, you know, it's bad. A lot of our friends and neighbors and people whose paths we crossed are going to be, you know, lost throughout eternity because we were scared, we were fearful, or we didn't have the motivation, we didn't have the zeal, we weren't fervent enough, we didn't give enough of ourselves to the Lord to have that burning and unction to snatch them out of the, you know, the pit of hell. It's really, you know, the import of that is not going to hit you until you actually experience that before the judgment seat of Christ. I mean, it's going to, amen, it's going to hit you like, how many tons of bricks? All right, it's going to hit your heart. Okay, those are two scriptures. Ecclesiastes 12, 13 and 14. Now, it would be good to meditate on that. Now, in order for you to be able to experience this or to do this or to fulfill God's design for your life or the purpose that God has designed for your life is that we have to write down Titus 2. Okay. It shows you in Titus 2 that you can actually accomplish everything that God requires of you, but you will not be able to do it on the basis of your ability or your works or your human strength or human knowledge. It's got to be through the grace of God. It's got to be through the grace of God. Amen. So the Bible says, be strong in the grace of God. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God. So Titus 2, those are scriptures that shows that God makes everything that He requires possible to every believer. First by appearing, you know, the grace of God that appears unto all of us. The grace of God that brings salvation. Okay. Is accomplished, number one, by salvation. Amen. There's no way nobody can do what God wants them to do or fulfill our responsibilities as believers and to fulfill the purpose that God has called you unless you're saved. You got to be what? Saved. The grace of God has already what? Brought salvation. Check somebody said the grace of the salvation is already a fact. Amazing grace. How what? Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Once was lost, but now found. Was glad. How many know that Satan is glad in the eyes of those that who believe not, glad in their minds? Because he don't want us to what? To receive the gospel. He doesn't want the gospel of Jesus Christ to what? Break through and dawn on us and impact us and change our spirits and cause God's power to what? Come in and dwell in us, making our bodies the temple of the Holy Ghost. The devil doesn't want that. He'll fight it all the way. That's what he doesn't want. But the grace of God has already appeared. Woo! I can shout on that. And you can shout about the grace of God. Amen. Praise God. You can do some shouting. The grace of God that brings salvation has appeared unto all men, yes. Teaching us that denying, in other words, denying ungodliness and what? Worldly lusts. That we should what? Okay. And what? And what? Godly in this present world. Okay. All of that is for a purpose. And the purpose for all of that is that God wants us to be able to stand. He wants us to walk as His dear children, the path of victory, leading an overcoming life, free and separated from sin, dominion over Satan, the world, and the flesh. He wants us to walk like that in order for us to be able to what? To be motivated and qualified and even established in truth to the extent where we will begin to be zealous of good works. So that's the thing that purges us from all of our iniquities and sin and really causes a transformation and I've managed to occur the teaching. Even teaching us, the grace what? Has to what? Teach us. And that's what we're trying to get over, the teaching that we get, the fivefold ministry gives. All of the teachings are designed to edify the body of Christ, to establish us in truth, so that we can be purged, cleansed from all iniquity. Everybody say all iniquity. And be a special call out, chosen people that will be zealous of what? Good works. Okay, so y'all can see in that particular passage in Titus 2 that the grace of God not only brings salvation, but the grace of God what? Gives us what? Overcoming what? Power. Is that right? Overcoming the flesh, the world, and what? Satan. All right? Why is that important? We've asked that repeatedly. Why is that important if we are going to serve the Lord? Amen. With fear and a way that it will be acceptable. Why is that lifestyle so important? Bible talks a whole lot about purging us from all iniquity, cleansing us from all sin. That is important. That's imperative because most people that I have seen, when you are doing things that displease the Lord, you just don't feel good about what. Being bold, I mean, you can't be bold in things that you are dealing with, or if you're confronting Satan, or if you are trying to convince somebody, if you're trying to minister to somebody, if you're trying to encourage somebody or lift somebody up, you just don't feel what? Good. You just feel what? Defeated. You feel like you what? You are not up to par, and you feel unworthy, or you feel like you are not capable of doing, carrying out your role. Okay, let's go to that's great. Now, the three things you want to see is saving grace, keeping grace, what we call it, keeping grace, standing grace, overcoming grace, all of it basically the same thing. And the third thing is ministering grace. That's the serving ability that we get. See, God has made us able ministers of a new covenant, and that is a scripture that we want to keep in mind. He has made us what? Able ministers. Everybody said, able, able. Turn to somebody and say, you're able. You're able. You're able minister of the new what? Covenant. Okay. That is a part of the grace of God that gives us the ability to minister. Okay. Write this down. 2 Corinthians 3:5. Not that. 2 Corinthians 3:5. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. Who also has made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. Okay, we can continue to read, but that shows that the grace of God to do what God is requiring in terms of ministry has already been released into our lives, and we have no excuse. If we pray, amen, with passion, pray with fervency, open up our lives, pray with brokenness, releasing ourselves and not holding back and looking while everybody else is doing. I'm terrible tonight, I know. But this is something that praise team, everybody knows this, that many times people don't give hardly anything when it comes to worship of the Lord. And the Lord is saying, they that worship him must what? Worship him in what? Spirit and truth. Okay, so this is how the grace of God comes when you humble yourself and when you obey and love the Lord in all sincerity. You know, these abilities are the grace that we need in order to accomplish whatever God has called us to do. These things begin to be released into our lives when we let go and let God. That's what we call humbling ourselves before the mighty hand of God. And the Bible says if we do that, he will exalt us in due time. So you got the 2 Corinthians 3 scripture. Somebody said, well, I can't do what God says. No, I can't witness. I can't help that. Now, some of y'all are better at this than even me as a leader. You can persuade people. Now, Sherita on the night had last Thursday or Thursday before, Wednesday night before, she had one of her friends here. She talked her into coming up here and sitting up and listen to the word. And the friend said, I want to come back. And I believe she's coming back.
Yeah, she had to work tonight.
She had to work tonight. Yeah. See
that? But she said she'd come back, though.
Okay, now, did I take some kind of special ability on your part?
No, I just talked to her.
Oh,
is
that all you did?
Yeah, I just told her that this
Roger
Wednesday night. She said, well, I'm not going on this Wednesday. Can I come?
I said, is that easy? Okay. All right, Sister Sherry. you believe it's that easy? Okay. Let me ask somebody else. Sister Pearl, you think it's that easy? Brother Sonny, are you back there tonight? Do you believe it's that easy?
Really?
All right. Let me ask two or three more people. Brother Al, is it that easy? How you get on the come, Brother Al? What, is that all you do?
Yeah.
You don't pray them? You don't offer them money? Oh, gosh. Okay, let me ask this question. If it's that easy, why don't we do it? Is it because we don't want to? We're too busy? We don't think it's important. We don't like it. We think that we ain't capable of doing it. Okay, y'all tell me which one of them y'all think. Because, you know, a lot of times the newer people seem like it's easy for them. I think so. I can't remember who that last brought somebody. Oh, he was Sister Wayne's daughter. What's her name?
Angela.
Angela. How many of those teenagers did she have doing? I mean, that was Friday. That was Sunday. How many did she have?
I think she had about 8 or 10 of them.
I wonder how did she, you know, if she hadn't mentioned anything, they sure wouldn't have showed up on their own. All right, so that's kind of like a review, but I don't mean it to be rebuked, but the Bible did say that we have to rebuke, exhort, right? And Brother Rod, do you think that everybody can get somebody in the pew?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Okay. Now, it goes a little further than getting them in the pew. Okay, what else next? You got to get them in the pew. That's an A-plus if you get them here in the pew. That's good. All right, what's the second thing you got to do after you get them here in the pew? Turn them over to me?
Follow up.
Sister Perry? Okay, keep talking with them. If you got them in the pew, you can what? Your efforts are what? Try to keep them in the pew.
Yes.
And to place them in a position where they can what? Learn the word. Now, there's nothing wrong with bringing new people to Wednesday night. I know that many times they need a whole lot of foundational teaching, but everybody don't go to a new members class, and everybody, you know, everybody will eventually catch it. Teaching like tonight, the grace of God, simple truths, even like Justice Act, they need to be listening. They can understand what I'm saying just as good as they understand this stuff coming up. I mean, it takes persistency to even get them here in the pew. Try one time, they back out. Try two times, second time, what? They back out. Just keep on trying. Amen. And eventually, they will what? They'll, because the Lord is working. See, when the Lord speaks through you and mentioning them to come, that's the way that God is what? Sending warning. And that's what having an impact on their spirit. That's registering on their spirit. See, I just think it's just a human effort. No, this is a command God has given you, and you're carrying it out, and the Holy Spirit is working in that effort that you put forth. And everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
All right, let's have some responses. Why don't more saints do it? We could have the church filled to capacity if everybody would just obey. I do put it in the category of what obeying the Lord. Serving the Lord, there's no admonition, there's no command that's greater than reaching out to people whose path you cross, people you know, people that's within your grasp or reach or your surroundings, that you wouldn't take part in any special effort part of that much. They respect you. They would respond to your request, but many times it will take what? Persistence. All right, everybody say amen.
Amen.
Okay, let me give you this scripture in Colossians. It says, and this is something that we need to pray about, because I think including in our prayer life, our personal prayer for ourselves and the prayer lives of others, we need to pray this particular prayer, Colossians 1:9. By this cause we also, now this is a prayer that you can just take directly from the Bible, and you can pray, and things will begin to improve if you really begin to pray this particular prayer, because we really need to pray that the saints of God really begin to move in the direction that we are trying to teach you tonight. Okay, for this cause we also, everybody have Colossians 1:9, for this cause we also, oh, I see this church full. I see this church full, because I believe that everybody here, God is going to give a desire to reach somebody. And I believe that next month is going to begin to happen. I want to see every, y'all don't hear me. I want to see what? Every person that really want to obey God. And I'm going to put myself in the same category. Okay. For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. See, if we pray that prayer and the Lord really begins to illuminate the importance of knowledge of his will. See, understanding what the will of the Lord is a big issue. And if we ignore God's will, Bible says, how shall we escape if we neglect such salvation? How shall we escape? That you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. So this is talking about being pleasing and being fruitful. That means obeying and serving. I know my time is out, but Philippians 1, we prayed. This is another prayer, Philippians 1, and this I pray, that your love, see, love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and all judgment, that you may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. All of this is taking us right back to what God really wants us to actually do. Okay, being filled. Again, everybody said being filled with the fruits of righteousness. Those are things that we do in the area of serving. That's reaching out, ministering, getting people in the pews, encouraging them to come back, giving them something to what? Build their spiritual life up with. Giving them information, materials, CDs or DVDs or whatever you can give them. And call them and check on them. Take them out for a dinner or, well, McDonald's if you can pay for nothing else. Build a relationship with them. So many people have visited here and come consistently,
And many times we don't even get their name. We don't know their name. We know somebody have their names, but the membership as a whole don't even know them. See, those are souls that the Lord has placed right in your notebook under you, right? In your, I mean, right under your breast. I was thinking about a brother that had all these children. I missed him for a few Sundays. And I wonder how many brothers even know his name or have his telephone number. All right? This kind of Bible said there comes a time where we want to endure sound doctrine. Now, I know I'm teaching tonight, but look how solemn people look. They y'all looking at me like I'm preaching it in Greek. Okay, I'm done. Okay, Jude, I'm going to just give you this scripture to ponder under. This is the scripture that really shook me up a few weeks ago. Jude, it says here. So all of these scriptures are talking about being filled with the fruits of righteousness. That means that your works, that means being zealous of good works. Be careful to maintain good works. We have his workmanship created unto Christ for what? Good works, where he has foreordained that we should what? Walk in them. There's a plan, path, purpose that God has what? Established for every single one of us. And this is the thing that we will need in judgment. Okay, Jude, this is, he says, but Jude 20, there's not a, but one chapter. But ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keeping yourselves in the what? Love of God. All right. See, that other prayer was pray that you may abound more and more and more and more and more and more and more in love. I mean, being concerned. Don't let people just fall into hell without you doing your part. Amen. Do everything you can. Withhold not good from them to whom it is due when it is in the power of your hand to do it. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Watch this. And some have compassion, making a difference. And others say with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Some people, you're going to have to be very gentle, very kind. You're going to have them with kids' gloves. You're going to be very gentle. I mean, because sometimes people are not operating with what? Knowledge and understanding. And you have to what? You have to be mindful. That's the reason the Bible says, keep yourselves in the what? Love of God. So you don't want to just, so you go into hell. You lost and don't know it. You lost and can't help it. You lost and can't do nothing about it. You're going to hell. Okay. But other people, once people have gotten adequate warning, adequate knowledge, when they have been exposed to truth, when they just deliberately spurn the word of God, the warning that you are going to give them to save their life from death, then the Bible says, handle them a little bit more what? Stern. Get tough on them. But don't overplay your hand. Amen. Some people you're going to have to what? Use fire and brimstone. Some people you're going to have to know that they're righteous, the unrighteous, and the whoremongers, and the perverts, and the adulterers, and fornicators, and covetous, and will not inherit the kingdom of God. You're going to have to use some heavy scripture sometimes on people that resist and spurn the truth. So you have to know both sides. There's a love side of God. Then there's a what? Judgment. I'm done. Amen. Okay, but I want you to start working on your people. We're going to be consecrating this week. We are doing light stuff. How many understand what light stuff is? Daniel's fast. If you haven't done it, anything, tomorrow is what? Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Amen. You can join in and just cut it back, no meats or stuff like that, and just eat naturally. Everybody said naturally. They're trying to do a partial fast, and we're not going to be eating as fast as we can. All right, so let's begin to... Okay, the Book of Acts, how many there? Amen, the Book of Acts, it is a must. It will feed your spirit like nothing. Okay, the other book, we told you Matthew before, the other books that deal with serving the Lord and works, and the attitude, the disposition, and all that you need in order to be effective is found in the book of 1 John. I know all the epistles are very important, but everybody said St. John. I might say 1 John, but let's say St. John. You really want a book of the Bible that really deals with things that where we are, works, and the spirit that we need to do them in, and how we need to depend on God and trust God, that would be the book of St. John. Everybody say St. John. And the book of what? Acts. Everybody say that. Now, you're free to read everything that you want to read, but those are some things that have really blessed me and really helped me to be as passionate as I am. Everybody stand. Let's all stand. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now, henceforth, and forever. Everybody say together, praise the Lord. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you.